In this macro photography tutorial, I'm going to explain how to get really large focus stacks of screws. They're going to make for a really great subject for demonstrating how to get really sharp images of a very deep subject. So I'm going to get started and I'll see you in just a sec. Hi guys, I'm Ben from Adaptalux, and today I'm doing a little bit more focus stacking. I did some focus stacking in a video a couple of weeks ago. I'll link that up here if you want a really simple, basic method to get a very quick photo stack. Today I'm going to be stacking a lot more photographs because I'm taking pictures of screws. I'm going to be jumping into my toolbox, grabbing both some used and unused brand new screws, and I think they're going to make a really interesting subject just on their own because they've got a lot of detail, and especially when you get close, there'll be a lot of nicks and scratches, some paint on some of these screws as well. So I think they're going to look really cool when we get up close, but also they're going to make for a great demonstration of how to get large focus stacks. They're a very deep subject, so we need to get a very deep depth of field. So I'm going to grab my toolbox, grab some screws, some lighting, and my camera, and we can jump right in to get our first image. I've come down to my coffee table, which is going to be our shooting surface for today. It's made of glass, so it's going to give us some nice reflections of our screws as they sit on the glass surface there. I think that's going to be really nice, particularly with our lighting. The other thing that we're going to need is obviously a camera. I've got the D5600 here with a 100mm macro lens. That's going to get us plenty close enough to get some nice details in our screws. The other thing that you're going to notice is this little piece of equipment that sat on top of my tripod. That's a focus stacking rail. It's a manual rail, so I'm going to be making very fine adjustments to the position of our camera as we take our shots. This is very important that you have a means of adjusting your focus or your camera position in very, very fine increments, because when you're taking shots this close, you need to be moving the camera or the focus by millimeter increments, or even smaller than that if possible. So I'll show you a little bit more detail how that's going to work in just a second. Let's take a look at our lighting. This is the Adaptalux Studio. This is the control pod, and it's sat on a little mini tripod. It's designed for macro photography, so we have these flexible lighting arms which make for really easy application of light to our subject. I can simply plug in a lighting arm and straight away bring light down onto our subject. From there, it's really easy to adjust exactly where you want your light to fall. You can also adjust the color of the lights in a couple of different methods, one of which being adding a colored lighting arm. You can see that this one is blue, so when I plug this one in, it's going to provide some nice blue light onto the side of our subject. But we can also change the light by adding colors, color filters and diffusers. So if I plug, say, a blue color filter in on this side, you can see that we now have entirely blue light. If I change that to an orange color filter, we've got orange on one side and blue on the other side. I'm going to go for something a little bit more conservative to start off with. I'm going to pop a nice diffuser on the white arm here, and then I'm going to maybe move that blue light a little bit further away, just so it's creating a very small highlight on the back of our screw. Now that we've got some lighting set up, it's time to think a little bit more about our composition. You need to move your camera so that it's focused on either the very back end of the screw or the very front of the screw. Because we're going to be moving in increments from front to back, or vice versa, back to front. So I've got mine focused right on the head of the screw here. And I've left quite a lot of space around the edge simply because we're going to lose a little bit of that space when we crop down our image after our stack has been completed. So if you can leave a little bit of extra space, expecting to lose a little bit from around the edges. I'm actually going to move mine a little bit further back from this, just so that I can keep enough of the screw in the frame. Now that I've got some lighting and I've got my settings decided in my camera, it's time to start taking some pictures for your stack. but there's a couple of things that you don't want to change during this process, one of which is your settings. You don't want your exposure to change between the shots. You don't want one slice of your image to be slightly brighter or darker than the rest. So flick over to manual mode and make sure that you don't change your settings from picture to picture. I'm about ready to start shooting, so I've got my shutter release cable plugged in. These things are really cheap and they're very handy for making sure you don't knock the camera when you're trying to keep it particularly steady. The one thing that I am going to change is the position of my camera using our macro focus rail. So this thing, I can just change the dials here, move the camera forward and back, and you can see that that's moving the point of focus through the image from front to back. Now the reason that I'm going to be going front to back, I'm just going to put this on the very first point of focus at the very front of my screw. I'm going to be going front to back simply because my camera is at a slight angle and it's slightly easier to get an accurate movement going forwards downhill than it is going backwards. It really doesn't make a difference as long as you're taking your pictures in sequence front to back or back to front, it will be just fine. So I'm going to be making the smallest possible movements with my macro rail. It's almost an exercise of how little you can move the camera, taking pictures as you go. I'm actually going to turn it off live view so that I can take one picture after another, just moving my camera ever so slightly each time. Now that I've got a nice sequence of images, I'm going to jump over to my PC and show you a little bit of how to process them into that final stacked image. I've loaded all of my images onto my PC and I've opened up Helicon Focus. This is a standalone piece of software. It is paid for, but there's a trial version. So if you want to go and try this out, you can go online. I'll put a link down in the description to grab the trial version of Helicon Focus. Try it out for yourself. I do think it's a much more powerful stacking option than just doing it in Photoshop. Obviously, if you're used to Photoshop, that is an option. But today I'm going to be using this and giving it a go to see what kind of results we can get. The first thing that I need to do is go and grab my stack of images. And I can do that either by dragging them onto this panel here or going to the plus symbol and opening them up out of the folder that I've placed them all in. So I can just shift click all of these, grab everything and click open. And then you'll see that they're all in here. We've got a stack of 158 images. Now these are all in RAW. I didn't feel like converting them to JPEG first. I think it would just take just as long to save all of these and then bring them in here as JPEGs as it would add the extra time in processing them straight in RAW. So I'm just going to give this a go and give it a little bit of extra time to process. Now that we've got all of our images in here, we need to choose a rendering method. Now there's three different methods down here and they each are suited to different types of images. Method C down here is particularly good at very complex images, but it will increase the contrast and glare of your images, so it might change the way that they look a little bit. Method B is my preferred method for images like this, particularly because I've taken them in sequence. I've got every shot slicing through the image front to back and they're all in order, which is a requirement for this method B. It's going to create a depth map as it goes through, so I'm going to be using this one. Method A, as you can see here, is a weighted average, so it's going to take a look at all of the pixels and decide what's most in focus across the entire stack. I'm going to use method B and I'm going to leave the radius and smoothing settings at default to begin with. Now you can change these and perhaps you should, but I would recommend starting at these default settings and then working from there. You can render this as many times as you like and see what difference these make. Generally speaking, the lower these are set, the more detail, the more sharpness you're going to get out of your image, but the more artifacts and strange goings on that it's going to create. It's basically looking for the detail in your image and deciding whether or not it's noise, and it's going to filter that out or not, as the case may be. The Helicon Focus software actually comes with some really great help articles online. So you can hit this little button up here and go and read more about what each of these settings do and how it's going to affect your images. What I would recommend though is just hitting render and seeing exactly what difference changing these settings make. Something that I particularly like about this software is that it's going to save our file as a TIFF, and it's going to put in the file name exactly what settings you use. So you can render multiple images, save multiple images, and you'll always know which settings were used in the software itself. Now you can see it's actually visually representing the render here for us, which I think is a really nice touch. It's not something that you get to see in Photoshop, particularly when Photoshop is running so slowly. It just sort of seems to freeze up and then spit out an image at the end. With this, you can see it's processing. You can see the image building up in the depth map here. And if I just leave this to go for a little while, we'll come out with a nicely stacked image in the end. With that completed, you can see the difference that we've got here. We've now got the full length of the screw in focus. We've got all of the reflection in focus as well, but it has brought all of these little scratches on my glass, as well as little bits of dust and hair. Those are all going to need to be cloned out. You can avoid that if you've got a nice clean surface to work with, but for now I'm just going to jump over to Photoshop and pull all of these out using the clone tool. The other thing that you can do here is start exploring and adjusting your images. So of course you can make adjustments to your radius and smoothing settings. You can try a different rendering method and see if that works any better or worse. And you can actually see down here that we've got method B, we've got setting for 8 on our radius, and we've got setting for 4 on our smoothing. And as you process more and more, as you render again, it will bring up a new image, and you can compare all of these as you go to decide which settings work best for your particular shot. For now, I'm pretty happy with this one. I'm going to jump over to Photoshop and just remove some of these, and then we can take a look at the final image.
I think this has been a really interesting little subject. I've obviously shot a few more than just that one that we've been working on today. Different colours in our lighting, different angles, and of course different screws, both with battle-worn scars all over them, a little bit of paint and damage from screwing them in and out, and of course a few new ones as well, which are interesting in their own right, just because there's always some imperfections when you get up this close, and I think it's really interesting to reveal those. I really enjoyed trying out a new method for photo stacking as well. There's a few different ways to do this, different types of software, so this is by all means not the only way, but I think it was really successful today. If you have some comments for me on my results or my methods, let me know down in the comments section of the video, and give the video a like if you enjoyed it. Make sure to subscribe if you want more macro photography tutorials, ideas, and inspiration in the future. For now though, guys, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.